In today's episode, guys, our topic is going to be varied and spread out through a series of questions, Q&A format. So let's get right into it. They're going to be asking me some interesting questions that you guys could partake and learn from.
And this question is coming from CARMEN in San Antonio, Texas. Rick, she wants to know what the best way to protect your property from lawsuits or creditors.
Thank you, CARMEN, for asking us this question regarding how is the best way possible for an individual to protect your investment from creditors and most importantly, lawsuits. I hear the majority of the people say that the easiest way is to put your home or your property under an LLC, but that couldn't be further from the truth, and here's why. The inception of an LLC, or the original design and scope of an LLC, is designed to serve for income-producing assets. And I'll give you some examples that I want you guys to write down. We're talking about, let's say, if you have a cabin rental house or a beach rental house, or even, especially in Texas, since I live in Texas, there's a lot of farmers that have income-producing crops, right? And of course, myself, that I really designate a heavy portion of my real estate portfolio into passive income through Airbnb. All of those different types of property fall under an umbrella that would be very conducive for you to put your property under an LLC, at which would protect you and provide safeguards for you. But it's not meant for the individual who is living in their home as their primary residence. So there's other safeguards for that, which in the state of Texas and a lot of the states in our country, there's a scenario called the homestead exemption, where you claim your primary residence as your homestead to get a small tax break, but most importantly, so it protects you from creditors and potential lawsuits. So that's the way I would do that if you are looking to have some safety measurements to protect you from individuals like that.
Rick, Ray from Scottsdale, Arizona wants to know, if I want to invest money on one of your projects and let you do all the work, what is the minimum required?
Thank you very much, Ray from Scottsdale, Arizona, for asking us this question regarding what is the minimum down payment that is needed when you're looking to launch your real estate investment career. My answer is there was really no clear-cut answer because real estate investing has so many different faces to it. And there's so many different ways where you could begin launching into the real estate investing. For example, a lot of my agents here, they don't necessarily have to have the entirety of a project to begin real estate investing. You could do what I call micro investing or joint investing. Joint investing, the way I label it, is pretty simple. You have two people, you could have more people, but for this example, let's say you have two people and a project's $100,000, you each put $50,000, you each are 50% owners on it, and you each get the 50% of the profit. There's so many different ways to unravel that. Let's say one person is the capital investor, meaning they're the ones who are bringing in the funds. And then the next person is the one who's going to be doing all the heavy grunt work, organizing the contracting, the city permits, the renovation, going shopping and doing everything that is necessary to get the house in its prime condition. So one person could bring the money, the other person can do the sweat work, and then they both split the profit according to how you come up to your agreement. What I mean by micro investing, that's really for the newbie investor that doesn't have a lot of capital but wants to jump into real estate investing. And the way to do that is pretty simple. Let's say, once again, let's to give the numbers and make it pretty easy. Let's say you have a $100,000 property. And let's say I have $80,000 that I want to jump in on. And then one of my agents or one of my friends or one of my clients says, Rick, I only have $20,000. So my 80 plus their 20 equals 100 all in of what's necessary for that project. So I own 80% of the share and my partner owns 20% of the share in this case. And let's say we make $40,000 profit. When it's all said and done, to make the numbers super easy, let's say we make $40,000, guys. Well, 80% of that $40,000, off the top of my head, we're looking at $32,000. So I would get, since I own 80% of the property, I would get $32,000 of that $40,000 profit, plus get my $80,000 back. So that is a great, great payday. I put in 80 and I make 32,000. I'll take that every day of the week, twice on Sunday. That's why I love micro investing. And it's not a bad scenario for my newbie investment partner, because they put 20, once again, that's all they put in, they put 20. But then out of the $40,000, I made 32, 40 minus 32 equals $8,000. So my micro or newbie investor is making $8,000. They put 20 and they make $8,000. If you want to internalize that and do a rate of return, you're looking at around 40%, if I'm not mistaken, 40% rate of return. That is substantially better than anything you are gonna get in the stock market. And guess what, guys? It's a lot more fun to do it as well.
Carmen from San Antonio, Texas, had the following question. Please explain the benefits of Airbnb.
For those people who do not know me, I have really transferred a lot of my rental portfolio from a more of a traditional one-year lease type of platform to going pretty much all in for the most part, with the exception of a few duplex properties that I have, going all in on the Airbnb space. And here's why, even more so now with COVID coming in. So the benefits of having an Airbnb in comparison to having a traditional tenant on a one-year lease inside your space are pretty simple. So I would write these down if you wanna have these handy for you. Number one is you're not going to have any eviction headaches or problems, especially with what's going on with COVID. A lot of people are unfortunately losing their job and they don't have money to pay for rent. So if I had my property on an Airbnb space, they are short-term rentals. They book and pay ahead of time. I have zero eviction problems. Whereas if I have a one-year tenant and they lose their job, unfortunately, and I also need to get paid on that. So there we have a problem. Do I evict them? Am I compassionate? You will avoid that headache altogether when you're doing an Airbnb space. So that's number one. The second one is that we have less wear and tear and usage on the home. And here's why. So let's imagine that you and your family are traveling to Disneyland. And as you guys are traveling to Disneyland, you're staying in the Disneyland Hotel. Well, you're not gonna stay at the hotel room 24 hours out of the day. You're actually gonna go there to sleep, to shower, to get ready, and then head out to the town, go to Disneyland, go to the beach, go do whatever it is that you need to do. But you're not using the hotel room like you would use the home if you were living in it for a whole entire year. So the consumption, the usage of it, and the wear and tear of it is substantially less, because the majority of my bookings will be anywhere from 2 days. And sometimes I have long-term stays according to what Airbnb would consider long-term stays, like a month or sometimes even 2 months, but they still do not last a whole entire year. So that's another reason, so that my property is going to look a lot better. And number three, guys, is that we are not going to have any messy tenants when you're going through an Airbnb. Even if the people are messy during your stay at the Airbnb, they're there for a short term. So you shouldn't have to worry about it. I'm gonna get my cleaning crew to come in, and after they vacate the property or their booking reservation's done, I go in and my cleaning crew sanitizes the place and also has it professionally cleaned. So our properties are being cleaned after each renovation prior to the new booking, because you wanna have great reviews as they're booking your spot. So you are not gonna have a compounding effect of dirty tenants throughout the course of them living there. And that is a great, great reason. I come from a clean household. My mom always has her space clean. So this is a better way for me to look at investing. And number four, which by far, I would not even be doing Airbnb for the other three reasons if number four was not put into place. And that is cash flow, cash flow, cash flow. Cash is king when you're looking at investing into real estate with passive income. I'll give you an example. Let's say you have a house, guys, that you guys are considering renting, and you have a house and you're renting it for $1,000 on a one-year lease to a tenant, okay? That house, if you were to Airbnb it, let's say you were to get $100 per night, for example, and here's where it gets really interesting. My investment properties on Airbnb, they average anywhere from 20 to 22 days of occupancy. That means they are booked for 20 to 22 days out of the month. So that means I have 8 days of sucking. That means I have 8 days of vacancy. And I love that, because I don't have to be perfect on Airbnb. I don't have to have a home run. I don't have to have a slam dunk or a game winner at the buzzer. I literally could suck 8 days out of the month and still have 20 to 22 days occupied on that home and still make substantially a lot more money than I would if I was doing a one-year lease. So based off of that example, you have $100 per night, and if I were to rent it at 22 nights per month, you're looking at $2,200 of gross monthly income. And guess what, guys? I also charge for cleaning. So let's say my cleaning is anywhere from $60 to $100 per reservation. If I have maybe 6 to 8 cleans, you're now adding an additional extra income, and plus any miscellaneous income. Like, let's say a couple of times they would say, Rick, we arrived from the airport 4 hours early. Can we do early check? And I said, let me check with my cleaning crew, but it's going to be $35 extra. So I collect extra little fees here and there. So my total gross monthly income can be possibly $2,500 a month. After I pay my cleaning crew, after I pay my utilities and internet and all the other stuff that I need to pay, I may walk away in this scenario with more than $1,000 to $1,500, even $1,700 of positive cash flow. I love it. I love it. You multiply that times 4 or 5 properties, and guess what? You have a healthy retirement plan in place.
Hey, Rick, this is from Luis from here in El Paso, Texas. He wants to know, when investing in real estate, do you prefer to leverage, aka finance, as much as you can, or to be cash heavy?
All right. Thank you, Luis, for asking us this question from El Paso, Texas. You know, it really depends. And here's the reason why I say it depends: if you're going to be buying all cash, or if you're going to be using financing and leveraging. Real estate investors, they use that word leveraging. I love the word leverage because you're using other people's efforts or other people's brain, other people's energy, other people's mind to get you to the final destination. So there's two divisions between the real estate investment world. Some people, they like to carry no debt and buy all cash. And other people actually like to carry what I would say is good debt in order for them to acquire their investment portfolio. So my answer would be, it depends on a couple factors. It depends on where you and your family are at financially in your retirement plan. See, my scenario when I was 25 and I was investing heavily in flips with very few rental properties in my book, I would say I would leverage and leverage and leverage as much as you can initially, because that's where my mindset was. Well, I'm getting older, and I don't feel old. I'm getting older. I'm 40 years old, and I'm building for my retirement. I'm building for my gateway so that I don't have to work as hard on the back end. So I'm trying to eliminate my debt, okay? And I'm trying to see if I could compound or gather all my investment properties at the end of the day and sell them off to a newbie investor who is looking to have the business already laid out for him, okay? So it also comes down to, are you gonna be flipping, or are you gonna be trying to rent your property? And I'll give you an example. Once again, we'll do easy math. Let's say you have a $100,000 property and you have a $100,000 cash, okay? In the cash scenario, you will have zero debt. That's your big advantage. You could do a lot of things after you have zero debt. Then you could refinance the property after you renovate it, and you could sell it off. You could make a substantial profit. Or the disadvantage is, obviously, now you're not gonna be left with any capital, okay? Or you could leverage that property, or leverage 5 other properties. Let's say you put 20% down. Since you have 100,000, you could buy 5 properties, and in those 5 properties, you could put 20% down on each of those properties. 20 times 5, that means $100,000. So you will have the down payment to put 20% down, which is the minimum required for investment properties that are not considered your primary residence. 20% down on 5 properties, you now have 5 properties. Now that sounds great, but what if you don't cash flow? So the name of the game, Luis, is all about cash flow. If I'm gonna leverage my capital out, or if I'm gonna leverage myself out that way, I wanna make sure that I'm cash flowing. So the advantage is that you have more properties in your book. That's great with appreciation, tax benefits. That's gonna be super awesome for you and your family. But the downside of it is, some people are not ready to take on that gauntlet of having $400,000 in debt now. Once again, you put $20,000 in each of those 5 properties, that means you are now having, out of the 500, you're gonna have $400,000 in new debt. And if you're not careful, or if you didn't buy right on one of those properties, the turn in the market hits, and then all of a sudden you're underwater on some of those properties. So the name of the game is making sure you buy correctly on the front side, and making sure that you're cash flowing on those properties that you have a mortgage payment to do on, okay?
This person, Rick, is coming from San Diego, California. Gary's asking, what is a good ROI, or rate of return, when looking to invest in rental real estate?
Gary, I love me some San Diego, California, so I'm gonna try to answer this one as direct as possible. When everyone is always asking, what is a good ROI? For those people who do not know what an ROI is, you're looking at what's called the rate of return, that mythical number as to what makes me dance and want to jump into the real estate investment world. So my clear-cut, simple answer, don't get too cute. I want to outperform the stock market, guys. That's what I want to do. The stock market is much easier to invest in than in real estate investment, the investment world, because there's so many more tangible things that you have to take into account in real estate investment. You have contractors that may not deliver. You have mold or things under the, behind the wall, structural issues. Or maybe the market turns, or maybe you'd hire the wrong broker that doesn't know what they're doing, doesn't know how to sell the property. There's so many unique things going on when you're looking at real estate investment. The investment world. So the stock market is so much easier, but a lot of people are not willing to wait the long-term beautiful effects of compounding interest on the stock market. So historically speaking, I invest the majority of my stuff in the stock market in index fund investments. I use Vanguard as my go-to source to make it easy for me to invest in the stock market. I don't really do a lot of individual stock picking. I used to. I was pretty good at it, but I did not have the time nor the energy nor the passion to look behind the screen to see what's going on individually on those stocks. So I make it easier for myself, and I put all my money into index funds regarding a Vanguard portfolio, which is a lot easier. And we'll talk about how I invest in Vanguard in a different episode. But historically speaking, a long-term index fund will generate you anywhere from 7 to 12%. There's years that you'll actually make 25%, maybe even 30%. There's also gonna be years, guys, that you guys are gonna suck ass and you are gonna maybe generate 4% or even lose money. But the trend is, if you leave your money long enough in an index fund, you'll generate anywhere from 7 to 12, maybe even more, okay? Now, that's where my baseline is when I'm investing in real estate, rental properties. My ROI, I bare minimum want it to be at least 12%, or I actually want it even to be higher for me to want to dance into that property, okay? So first and foremost, let's dissect real quick. What are some four easy ways where you could generate wealth through rental properties in real estate? Number one, guys, write this one down. It's gonna be cash flow. You have a property that's $1,000, and then your rent is $1,500. Your cash flow is $500. You get five of those properties. Now you're looking at a nice little heavy retirement that's being prepared for you. The second way in which you could generate wealth through rental properties is appreciation. This is more of a hopeful parameter. It's not set in stone. We do not know when the market will turn for the worse. But historically speaking, just like the stock market, everyone's always going to need a piece of dirt to live on, and because of that, real estate will always be valued. So as a result, guys, the appreciation factor on real estate is what drives me into buying some rental property. If I buy cheap enough, I buy in a good area, I buy a good layout, 90-95% of the time, I will make my money on appreciation. You buy a property $100,000, you leave it there for 5, 10, 15 years. That property, with the right renovations, may be worth $200, $250, maybe even more later on. Okay. The third benefit, guys, in which you guys can make money or acquire wealth through rental properties is your tax benefits and write-offs. These are ways in which the rich or the wealthy are able to legally write off their tax expenses through their rental properties. You're talking about maintenance fees, commission fees, titles, transfers, your renovations, all those things, even your gas and your mileage and your maintenance on your car, all those things are the cool benefits of becoming a real estate investor with rental properties. And number four, debt payoff. You are the landlord. The tenant is going to be paying off your mortgage payment if you do have a mortgage payment on there. And every month, that mortgage payment or that mortgage balance is going to be reduced, thus increasing your equity into that property. And combining that with all the three other advantages of acquiring wealth through rental properties, you are going to have a really good nest egg. Okay. So at bare minimum, guys, to finish off this one, I want my cash on cash return to at least be 12%, which is what I would normally generate historically on a good year in index fund investing, guys. So there you have it, guys. Thank you once again for tuning in to my Wealth Talk episode. I look forward to answering your future questions so that I could do the best possible to try to give you the knowledge and tips and tools needed so that you could get yourself on the path to retirement and wealth building altogether for you and your family. You guys stay blessed, stay healthy, and we'll see you guys on the next episode.